Welcome to Cricket Jif Podcast. In today's show, we have another special guest with us. He's a very famous commentator, journalist, writer, and one of the very fine voices in the Caribbean. We have Fazeer Muhammad with us, who has covered over 100 test matches. And right now, he's joining us from Port of Spain. Fazeer, how are you? And how is the Ramadan and the quarantine life going on?
It's going fine. Assalamu alaikum, Ramadan Kareem to everyone. And hopefully you continue to enjoy the benefits of the last few days of this holy month. But with the COVID-19, thankfully, we in Trinidad and Tobago, which is my home territory, and indeed the Caribbean, we haven't had too many issues. There have been some positive cases. There have been a few fatalities here in Trinidad and Tobago. We've had 8, and we're grateful that we haven't had more. We're worried about maybe a second wave if we open up for more businesses and so on, which is happening all over the world. But alhamdulillah, right at this time, we are grateful that it could have been a lot worse, and we are managing well.
Yeah, Fazeer, and I was actually looking at some numbers of COVID-19 as well. And luckily, there is just one active case right now in Trinidad. And there are a lot of talks right now about cricket, about West Indies touring England. So do you see that tour happening, or there were also some news that West Indies, they have asked England to come to Caribbean and play that series here?
I think the idea of playing it in the Caribbean is a non-starter. I don't think that's going to happen. What we understand, and the authorities in the UK have confirmed, that they have given the green light at the moment, a provisional green light, for competitive professional sport to get underway on July the 1st. You'll know, of course, that the West Indies tour was due to have been played entirely in the month of June. No, that is not going to happen. What they are trying to do is to create what they are describing as a biosecure atmosphere, which means essentially that the players will almost be in quarantine for 14 days getting ahead to the 3-test series, and then stay in quarantine at hotels in the grounds for those 3-test matches. And then they might very well have to be quarantined returning back to the Caribbean. I don't think it's an idea that a lot of the players in the West Indies are really keen on. They're concerned about being exposed to a place like England, where they've had so many fatalities and so many cases of people contracting COVID-19. But the Cricket West Indies president, Ricky Skerritt, has said that, look, it remains open, but they're not going to jeopardize the health or the well-being of any of the players. So at the moment, I think it's very much up in the air, because what is happening with this situation, Mazhar, is that people are realizing what is really important. It's all well and good to get excited about cricket. We love the game. We love our sport. We love football. I'm waiting for Liverpool to win their first premiership title for 30 years, whether it happens or it doesn't happen. The most important thing is the health and the welfare of the players, the fans, everyone associated with the game of cricket.
And Fazeer, how do you see, the West Indies season? South Africa, they were supposed to tour, but I think that now the tour is postponed. Then the CPL as well, there's some other cricket as well. Do you see it happening in the Caribbean this year?
It's going to be very difficult, Mazhar, because at the end of the day, can you really feel confident staging an event probably without any fans, which is going to take away a lot of the atmosphere of the CPL, because I know fans throughout the world, certainly in Pakistan and other parts of Asia, they enjoy the vibe that you would get from the CPL. It might not have been the biggest of grounds, but certainly the party atmosphere was something that seemed to attract quite a bit of fans, apart from the cricket itself. And if you can't replicate that environment, it's going to be a question mark as to whether or not it makes sense just staging the tournament. And as you said, the mere fact that some of the other countries, New Zealand, South Africa, were due to tour the West Indies in July and August prior to the CPL, they would have expressed their concerns. They would have expressed their worries about whether or not they want to expose their players to a situation. Some have even suggested that the CPL might not have any international players. We've seen the 100 in England being postponed to 2021 because they recognize that it really won't have the impact without the international players. So let's wait and see what happens. But at the moment, I think no one is prepared to commit one way or the other, because things are changing so quickly. All it takes is for one or two players to test positive and everything is called off.
Yeah, and Fazeer, I would just like to take this opportunity to talk about some past moments of cricket as well. And since you are with us, I'm very excited to talk to you about that historic test match in Dominica 3 years ago. You called the last moments of that test match, and Pakistan won the series in the West Indies for the very first time. It was last test match of Misbah and Yunus. It was exactly 3 years ago, and it had a very interesting ending. I mean, Pakistan, they won with only one over to spare, and that reckless shot by Shaden Gabriel, it comes to mind as well. So Fazeev, my first question is, why did you do that?
I know you were coming with that, and indeed I was joking with my wife a little while ago, telling her that my fame, whatever fame I enjoy, has a lot to do with Shaden Gabriel, and indeed the fact that the shot that he played prompted my response, and at the end of the day, maybe it's earned me a bit more international exposure, but I really wish that I didn't have it, and he didn't play that shot, and the West Indies would have been able to play out for a draw for that series. But it remains one of the bewildering things in the game. You ask, I'm sure Shannon probably every now and then would play through in his mind and basically might have asked himself the same question. Why did he do that? It was just a moment of madness. And as it turned out, it was a fantastic finale to two deserving cricketers, Yunus Khan, Misbah ul Haq, a first ever test series victory in the West Indies. When you think about it, Mazhar, the quality of cricketers from Pakistan who would have come to the Caribbean from way back in 1958, you're talking about Hanif Muhammad, and 1977, Imran Khan, Mushtaq Muhammad, and so on. 1988, that famous series where Imran Khan feels that his team would have been robbed of the series victory because of the umpiring, especially in that critical final test match in Barbados. And then to come to 2017 and find yourself in a situation where you are poised to pull off that victory and then be denied by Ruston Chase with that excellent 100 and Shaden Gabriel. And basically with the last ball that he bowled in the series, it turns out that Yasir Shah was the match winner.
Yeah, it was really interesting. And I think the whole test match or even the series, it was very interesting because I remember that the first 3 days in Dominica, they were very dull. Pitch was like slow, outfield was slow. There was a lot of criticism actually on the quality of cricket. But then the game picked up pace in the fourth day. In fact, there was one situation when Misbah and Yunus got out, it seemed that West Indies might win it. And then on the last day, Ruston Chase, he was playing really well. And at one stage, it seemed that the series and the match will be drawn. So what are your memories of that last day? Did you think that West Indies would be able to save it?
I felt going into the last day that the West Indies would have been up against it. And indeed, in mid-afternoon, when the wickets started to tumble, I certainly felt it would be only a matter of time before Pakistan were able to finish the job. But it almost always seems that Pakistan are sometimes their own worst enemies. They get a bit agitated. They get a bit too worked up. In fact, just a couple of days ago, Derek Murray, the outstanding former West Indies wicketkeeper and World Cup winner in 1975 and 1979, he was talking about that famous partnership with Andy Roberts in the first World Cup in 1975, when the West Indies recovered from 166 for 8 and then 203 for 9 when we were able to get up the 267 to win. I know many of your viewers, even yourself, might not want to remember that. But the reason I bring it up is that he mentioned that it didn't take long for the Pakistanis to get agitated on the field, to start to doubt themselves, to start to try too many different things. And from the moment they recognized that, I think they were able to pull it off. In the same way in Dominica 3 years ago, I think Ruston Chase was a very calm, composed individual. He was urging on Shaden Gabriel. We felt Shaden Gabriel would have been cleaned up in next to no time by Muhammad Amir or any one of the other outstanding bowlers. Certainly Yasir Shah would have gotten him very quickly. It didn't happen. And you almost felt that, look, everything was going the West Indies' way. There was a catch off a no ball. There was a bit more fortune for Gabriel along the way. And with seven deliveries, you felt that the West Indies really were going to pull it off. I didn't think it was going to happen. But at that time, I felt that all Gabriel had to do was survive that last ball from Yasir Shah and the match would be saved.
And Fazeev, I would just like to talk about that piece of commentary a little more, because I feel that was the best piece of commentary or broadcast moment in 2017. Just like last year, we had Ian Bishop calling those great four sixes by Brathwaite in Kolkata. And I think even now, when we look at those clips on YouTube or Facebook, it gives us goosebumps. And the voice behind those moments, it has a lot to do with it. So I just wanted to ask that, do you plan words to say it, or it's just a natural reaction to that moment?
I think it's a combination of planning and instinct. I think what is fortunate is that when you've covered a lot of cricket, you encounter so many different things happening. I remember being the commentator when Brian Lara on radio, this is not television, scored that magnificent 153 not out when the West Indies won in Barbados by one wicket in the Test match, chasing 313. I think that's Lara's greatest innings of all time. But the drama and the pulsating excitement and the fans, you get caught up in it as a commentator. But you also want to keep in mind, you want to reflect not just a West Indian perspective, because I'm a West Indian, I want the West Indies to do well. But my job is to reflect the entire perspective on the game. So you need to recognize what is going on overall. So for example, going into that final delivery from Yasir Shah, basically in your mind, you're playing over all the possibilities. Is he going to survive? Is he going to get out? What do I say if he does get out? And as it turned out, it was purely instinctive. I think if I were a fan in the stands, when he played that shot, I would have said exactly the same thing, probably with a bit more colorful language, with some expletives that could not be said on air. So it actually worked out well. And I think what you try to do in a situation like that is that after your initial comment, whatever it is, why did he do that? Oh, amazing victory, oh, tremendous performance, brilliant, outstanding, whatever that initial reaction is, you then try to pause, even if it is for a few seconds, to take into context everything that is happening. And during those couple of seconds, after Gabriel was reacting, the images showed him being really crestfallen and dejected while Pakistan was celebrating, you then have to put the why did he do that next to the amazing finish for Pakistan, history for Pakistan, Yunis Khan, Misbah saying farewell, two outstanding servants of the game. And that's when you try to slow it down, because you can get excited very easily, start to talk too quickly, which has always been a fault of mine, trying to say too much too soon, too much at one time. And I think it's the benefit of that little bit of experience I've had in television commentary that allowed me to slow it down and realize that, yes, dejection for the West Indies, a really a crazy thing done by Shannon Gabriel, but at the same time, an amazing effort by Pakistan. Yasir Shah diving onto the turf, buried by his players, and then the tributes to Yunis Khan, Misbah Ul-Haq, and you talk yourself through that. And as the pictures are being shown to you by the director, you try to ensure that you're not just speaking out of your own sense of your importance or your so-called importance, but you try to color the pictures that you're seeing with some important bits of information that makes it a truly memorable occasion.
Truly. And even right now, I mean, after 3 years listening to you and remembering those moments, I'm again getting excited, because honestly, I did not enjoy that moment because I was sitting right next to you and I was just working on some stats. And later, but later when I saw those clips, it was amazing. And another clip from that year was when Shea Hope, when he won West Indies that game in Leeds, you were doing, I think, commentary on BBC, and they shared that clip as well. And that was equally amazing as well. And Fuzzy, since we are talking about commentators, there's one voice that, or one name that comes to mind from Caribbean, the great Tony Cozier. He passed away 4 years ago, and he's one of the finest voices in cricket. And I remember when he died, Michael Holding said that his legacy in Caribbean cricket is right up there with the likes of Gary Sobers. I think it was a great compliment. What are your memories of listening to Tony Cozier, or then later working with him?
Well, I will certainly endorse what Michael Holding would have said. For me, Tony Cozier is the Gary Sobers of cricket coverage. And I say coverage not just as a commentator on television, but he did everything. That's why he's the Gary Sobers. I don't think there's any cricket journalist broadcaster who would have done work to the extent that Tony Cozier did, virtually from a 15-year-old. He did his first coverage of cricket as a 15-year-old for his father's newspaper in his native Barbados when Australia were in the West Indies in 1955. For another 50 years, basically, he was the, for almost 60 years, he was the distinctive voice of West Indies cricket, world-class as a writer, as a broadcaster in television and radio, and with huge experience. And when I got into to cricket coverage, cricket broadcasting, firstly as a writer in 1988, actually the first test series I covered was the 1988 series between the West Indies and Pakistan, a very famous series, as we mentioned earlier. It was such an awe-inspiring experience to be sitting next to a Tony Kozier, because you had heard him all your life commentating cricket. And then when you met him, you recognized that this was a man who really lived cricket. He spoke so knowledgeably about the game. He was very strong with his views, which has often landed him in trouble with players, with fans, with others in the Caribbean who are very thin-skinned about his comments. But I think more than anything else, Tony's work rate, the amount of work that he did, the research that he put in, his level of preparation, the fact that you could never catch him off guard, whatever the situation. It's something that made me realize that really this is what it's all about. It's not just good enough to say, well, I'm a West Indian, I only need to know about West Indies cricket and talk about West Indies cricket. If you really want to develop your skills in this particular profession, you need to know everything about everybody else. And when the occasion happens, you have to transmit that enthusiasm. So for example, with that dismissal of Shannon Gabriel, it was to transmit the excitement of Pakistan pulling off that series victory. It's not about sounding downcast as a West Indian. And I think that's what I learned the most from Tony Kozier. The fact that you've got to be the supreme professional, never mind you might be a West Indian, never mind your internal loyalties, the fans out there must never know who it is you're actually supporting.
And Fazeez, since you have covered a lot of test cricket, over 100 test matches in so many countries, so many places, I just wanted to know that what's the most competitive series you have covered?
Well, that's easy. That's easy, Mazhar. 1988. And it's probably because it was my first series covering it for a local newspaper, the Trinidad Guardian, where I'd actually started my career as a full-time journalist. I'd been at a weekly newspaper earlier. But to cover that test series, I didn't go to Guyana for the first test. I was in Trinidad, of course, my home country, for the second test. And I followed the third test in Barbados on the radio. But the quality of that cricket, Mazhar, just the quality of that cricket, just in Trinidad and Tobago alone, it stands apart. When you think about Pakistan winning the first test match comfortably in Guyana, winning by 10 wickets, I think it was, and then coming to Trinidad and Tobago for a test match that seesawed through all 5 days, and even going into the final session with Ijaz Ahmed and Javed Miandad at the crease, and Pakistan on course for a famous victory which would have clinched the series, and then for Ijaz to be stuck down the leg side of Viv Richards, of all people. And then at the end, in the final over, for to have Abdul Qadir, who you'll recall famously defeated the West Indies in the World Cup in Pakistan in 1987, to be blocking out Viv Richards as the last man to ensure a draw. Not just the manner in which it ended, but it was the quality of the cricket, the quality of the cricketers that were involved. That will stand to me. When you talk about all of the players in action at the very height of their game, and you got the sense, and I'm speaking to Ramiz Raja about it as well, that Pakistan came to the West Indies determined and confident that they could beat this great West Indies team. Because remember, the West Indies had gone 8 years without losing a test series, and they would go another 7 years without losing a test series. Yes, umpiring decisions were crucial in Barbados, and maybe even to a lesser extent in Trinidad and Tobago as well. So I would have to say, even with all the cricket that has been played since then, that was way back in 1988. We're talking about 32 years. But when I look back on it, when I compare it with the cricket that I've been involved with, the cricket that I've seen, the cricket that I've followed, that stands to my mind as the most competitive test series that I've ever seen, even though it was just 3 matches.
Yeah, Fazeez, and even if we look at the records and the numbers, because obviously that series was played before I was born, but even when we look at numbers, I think in that period, Pakistan and West Indies, they played 3 consecutive series. All of them were drawn. Even in 1980, there were 4 test matches. West Indies came to Pakistan. They won only 1 test match in Faisalabad. So I think that the quality of cricket between these two teams was really competitive, as you said. And Fazeez, you were also part of, you came to Pakistan in 1997 when West Indies, they lost 3-0. What are your memories from that Pakistan tour? There was a very famous Yorker by Waqar to Lara. Shoaib Akhtar made his debut. What are your memories?
Well, that Yorker certainly stands out in my mind. But just the experience, Mazhar, of being in Pakistan. And I think one of the privileges of our sport and being involved as a broadcaster, you're involved as a statsman with various commentary teams all over the world. You've been basically everywhere, so you understand what it's all about. It's actually the experience of being in a different environment. And for those who might know the history of the Caribbean, where people from what was then India, British India, there was no Pakistan at the time, would have come to this part of the world, primarily to Guyana and then Trinidad and Tobago, what were termed indentured laborers. That was after the end of African slavery, and the British were basically looking for people to work on the sugarcane plantations. So my ancestors would have come probably from Uttar Pradesh, from around that period, 1837 to 1905. And therefore, there would have been that legacy of connection with the Indian subcontinent, with the food that we eat, a lot of the music that we would have listened to, the Bollywood and the culture, and of course, our faith, our religion, and so on. So actually being in Pakistan, visiting Pakistan and going to Peshawar and Pindi and Karachi and being in that environment, that was even more fulfilling than the cricket itself, primarily because the West Indies played so badly, losing two test matches by an innings, losing the third by 10, because the West Indies were really steamrolled. And that was the start of the slide of the West Indies. But yes, I still remember that Waqar Yunus yorker, because he really set up Lara beautifully, because he got a four, then a two, and then a two. And Lara, again, with that very high backlip, was going up for another expansive off-drive, only for that delivery to swing back into him, and he fell onto off his feet and had to be propped up, even as his stumps went scattering, and it was really a spectacular dismissal. But I think more than anything else, Mazhar, it was the privilege of being in a different part of the world, and almost a spiritual homecoming, because I would have known that Pakistan, if not Pakistan, the country per se, would have been the home of my ancestors. So that in itself was a very special feeling.
Yeah, and now with cricket coming back to Pakistan, we hope that that you will come here once again. And Fuzzy, there was another home series of Pakistan which they played with West Indies in 2016 in UAE. You were doing commentary in that series as well. And there was and in that series, Pakistan played their 400th test match. And commentators, they were asked to pick their all-time Pakistan 11s. And in your team, you had Wasim Raja and Salim Yusuf. Two very different choices. So what's the reason behind that?
Again, I remember getting a lot of criticism for it from my colleagues, because it made no sense to what they understood to be the very best Pakistan cricket. And I respect that. And I made it clear, and I think we all made it clear, that these were personal choices. I saw Salim Yusuf in that 1988 series as an excellent keeper, but also a dogged, defiant batsman. Because you'll have to remember, the West Indies had just introduced Kirtley Ambrose into their bowling lineup. They had Winston Benjamin, who famously squared up Javed Miander and hit the top of his off stump in the test match at Queen's Park Oval that had everyone jumping and dancing in the stands in Port of Spain. So you had Winston Benjamin, Malcolm Marshall, lethal, absolutely lethal at that time in his career. And Salim Yusuf was prepared to battle his way through that. So that's why Salim Yusuf, to me at that time, was someone I would have included. Wasim Raja, to me, that was the easiest one of all. Because the first time I saw Wasim Raja would have been in the Caribbean in 1977. Of course, you weren't even a twinkle in your parents' eye at that time. So we know, you know, you would have looked at the records for that. But just before that, he had scored 100 against the West Indies when the West Indies were there in early 1975. And then in the Caribbean, he won the hearts of West Indies fans because of the way he played. He was the top scorer for Pakistan in each of the first four innings of the series. He scored 100 in the Barbados Test match. He featured in a last wicket partnership of over 100 with Wasim Bari. But more than the runs, it was the way he batted. I recall him coming into bat in the second test in Trinidad. A wicket had just fallen. People were expecting maybe the night watchman to come in to save the premier batsman. But Wasim Raja walked in, and the first delivery he faced was a long hop from the left-arm spinner, Rafiq Jumadeen, and he pulled it over mid-wicket for six. And that, to me, was Wasim Raja. And I think that's why he was so loved in the Caribbean by West Indians and followers of Pakistan cricket as well, simply because he never let a loose ball go by. Sadly, he passed away not so long ago, but I think he still lives in the hearts of many West Indian fans.
Yeah, and he had a great record against West Indies, averaging 57. And that West Indies team, which had so many great fast bowlers, and the innings that you mentioned in Barbados, it came against the likes of Croft, Joel Gardner, Andy Roberts was there as well. So, and Fazli, now if we talk about, future of cricket, there is a T20 World Cup as well. West Indies, they are defending champions. We are not really sure that if the tournament will happen or not. But if it happens, do you think that West Indies, they are in a position to defend that title?
I think even if the West Indies are ranked 9th or 10th or 12th or 20th, they're a different team when it comes to a tournament. They are what you call a tournament team. And as Dwayne Bravo said a couple of days ago when he was interviewed about the team's chances, he said that this team, from his point of view, is actually better than the teams that won the T20 title in 2012 and 2016, simply because there's so much variety, there's so much potency in the batting lineup, there's so much extra pace as well. You've got O'Shane Thomas, even if Andrew Russell is not fully fit, he could be a factor as well. It really is a situation where the present crop of West Indies cricketers, they may not really be all that motivated to play for the West Indies and run-of-the-mill tournaments or little by-nation events here and there. But when it comes to a World T20, they are totally focused. As you said, we're not sure it's going to happen, but I think if it does, you're going to see a West Indies team that is supremely focused on retaining their title. That doesn't mean they'll win it. They could very well lose, because even when they won in 2016, they were fortunate. They lost to Sri Lanka in the group stage. They went to a super over against New Zealand. And then they needed those four sixes from Carlos Brathwaite in the final itself. So it's about luck as well. But I think the West Indies will always be a force in T20 cricket, and especially when they are motivated, as we saw in that series in Sri Lanka just a couple months ago before COVID-19 took over. When they really are focused, they are a dangerous team.
And even in Test cricket, they have put up some great performances in the recent past. They won a Test match in England, they beat England at home. So now if that series happens between England and West Indies, do you think that West Indies have a chance in the Test series as well?
I think that's going to be very tough, primarily because they won't have the ideal sort of preparation, primarily because of COVID-19. And I think that's why the authorities may be having second thoughts. What's the point of having a West Indies team go there that may not be fully prepared and therefore could be at a disadvantage anyway? The West Indies are notoriously bad starters. Even when you talk about that 2017 series with that famous victory in Headingley and the Shea Hope twin hundreds, let's not forget Craig Brathwaite got 100 and then a 94 as well. But they lost the first test match in Birmingham, a day-night test match, where they lost 19 wickets on the third day into the third night. So it's a notoriously bad situation for the West Indies when they go into a series sort of unprepared. And that could very well be the situation with this England series. But I know there's a lot of money riding on it, and a lot of this has to do with broadcast deals, so there'll be a lot of pressure on the authorities to have the series go ahead. I think it's going to be tough anyway for the West Indies, because they're a different team at home as against away from home. I think England, if the series is played, will start as favourites.
Well, Fazib, just last couple of questions. How do you see cricket's future after COVID-19? There are some thoughts about changing LBW laws or legalizing ball tampering. There's so many thoughts. How do you see cricket after COVID-19?
You know, Mazhar, I tend to look at it differently. I think in terms of the balance of power in the game. We can talk about fiddling with the LBW rule. We could talk about putting varnish on the ball so that you don't have to put spit on it, that people can contract any viruses or whatever. But the fundamental issue with the game is the imbalance. The issue where you have England playing almost twice as many test matches as Bangladesh, for example. The issue where you have teams play 5 test series, but other teams aren't allowed to play more than 2 or 3 test matches, yet you're gathering points for a World Test Championship where it's not a level playing field. The only way cricket is really going to grow and prosper to the extent where you can feel that every test series is a competitive one, which is how it was many years ago. Many years ago, when there were just 6 test playing nations, Mazhar, there was no Sri Lanka, no Zimbabwe, no Bangladesh, no South Africa, because they were isolated. The cricket was very, very competitive, because invariably every series was 5 test matches. and every team was well prepared with warm-up matches. And I know things have changed. It's a different world now. I know the schedule doesn't allow for five test series, but my argument is you cannot have a situation where India, England and Australia are dictating the pace to the other test playing nation. It has to be a level playing field where every series is three tests, three one-dayers, three T20s. And it's only when you do that that you're going to have a fair chance for every team to properly develop. As it stands now, Mazhar, you're always going to have the big nations, the big three, dominating and their series attracting the most audience, the most money, while the other teams, the other nations, the West Indies, the Pakistans, the Bangladeshis and so on, are left at the end of the table waiting for the crumbs, and the game is not going to prosper that way.
Yeah, Fazeer, just one last question. West Indies history is enriched with great fast bowlers, and we have seen so many pacers coming from the Caribbean. Who are your favourites?
That one is also easy. My favourite fast bowler, my favourite cricketer of all time is Andy Roberts. Because when I grew up, I was just 9 years old when Andy played his first test match in 1974 in Barbados. But just hearing about Andy Roberts, just watching him, he had this mean look about him. He didn't say much. He was involved in that partnership with Derek Murray that beat Pakistan in the World Cup. Famously, when we went to Australia in 1975-76, we were beaten 5-1. But that one test match we won in Perth was something that still sticks in my mind. Andy Roberts picking up 7 wickets in the second innings, and the West Indies demolishing Australia, which is why when I went to Australia for the first time in 1996-97, going to the Waka in Perth was sort of like a pilgrimage outside of the Hajj. That would have been more important, of course, the religion, but this was the cricketing side of it. And Andy Roberts, to me, my favourite cricketer of all time, but I'll have to say, the finest fast bowler of all time, Andy will have to be second, the finest will have to be Malcolm Marshall. From what I would have seen of Malcolm, from what I would have heard of him, having had the opportunity to chat with him here and there for the little time that he was coach of the West Indies before he sadly fell ill and subsequently died of colon cancer in 1999. He was without doubt the greatest fast bowler that I have ever seen. He had everything. He had pace, he had skill, he had the ability to cut the ball, to swing, to use the old ball, to use the new ball. I don't think I've ever seen anyone with the cunning, with the knowledge, the know-how, and with the meanness of a Malcolm Marshall. He has to be the greatest fast bowler in my estimation that I've seen from the West Indies, but Andy Roberts will still remain my favourite.
Yeah, indeed. Well, thanks, Fazeer. Thanks for being here. It was great talking to you. Great hearing from you about West Indies cricket, Pakistan cricket, and we hope that we recover from this pandemic and we will meet soon. And thanks for being here. All the best and stay safe.
Indeed. And it's a pleasure. Always good to talk to you, Mazhar. And you continue to stay safe with you and your family. And indeed, Eid Mubarak in advance to everyone who will be following this broadcast. And I trust that everyone is safe and sound with their families as well.